Are the Tigers still fading? And is Chicago now atop the AL wildcard race? And the NFL season is underway. Did the defending champs pick up where they left off against Dante and the Dolphins? It is on. Yo, what's the dealio? SportsCenter on the sidelines in fourth quarter mode all night long. Stuart Scott, Steve Levy. Hey, coming up as soon as it's over, all the highlights, all the analysis of the NFL season opener. It's the third straight year that the season opener involves a Super Bowl champion.
Stuart, contrary to what some sports fans might have you believe, you might be among them. The start of the football season does not mark the end of baseball. Big night in the AL Central wild card. We'll get to that shortly. As for the NL wild card, John Lieber and the Phils. Lieber taken out by Miguel Cabrera, his 25th homer of the season, to the Fish a 1-0 lead. Cabrera and Alfredo Amezaga.
Hey, hey, hey.
They can dance in South FLA. Ryan Howard, what do you think happens here? Exactly. Get out of town. Major league leading 54th homer of the season. You know, Albert Pujols only has 44. Top of the seventh, Chase Utley with two on. He does what Howard does. Off Randy Messenger down the right field line, a three-run jack. Utley's 26th. It was 10-4. Marlins trying to stay close. Josh Willingham, three-run shot off Rick White. Willingham's 22nd, make it 10-8. 11-8. Recently acquired Jeff Conine up with two on, and Conine a blast of his own. Home runs flying out of whatever they're calling that stadium in Florida these days, Dolphin Stadium. The Phillies go on to defeat the Marlins 14-8. So, here is your National League wild card race up to the very second. The Phils win has them 2.5 back of the Padres. San Diego is idle, as are the Giants. Obviously, the Marlins lost. The Reds and Astros also taking a breather. So really, only the Phillies gain any ground. Now on ESPN.com, Buster Olney says, Anibal Sanchez is no-hitter. The last time, not the last time we'll get excited about the Marlins before the season's over.
New indictment, same troubled athlete. Former Ohio State tailback Maurice Claret indicted today on new charges in connection with last month's highway chase and struggle with police. The 22-year-old was indicted on five charges after being found August 9th with four loaded semi-automatic weapons. Officers say Claret led them on a high-speed chase, was not affected by a stun gun because he was wearing a bulletproof vest, but was finally subdued with pepper spray. He is set to go on trial September 18th, Claret is, on another charge, separate charges of robbery stemming from another incident, a New Year's Day incident. Still ahead on SportsCenter. Manning family bragging rights at stake straight ahead. Peyton versus Eli on the Sunday night stage at Giants Stadium. Which brother will dominate and why? First the arrest, then the suspension, now the challenge to stop Ohio State's biggest threat. Has Texas found a way to do that without a key player? And the Dodgers at Shea hanging on to the NL West lead. A Mets inside the park home run, not helping. And there's a new leader atop the AL wildcard race. Don't go anywhere.
Coach, coach, what do you know about this new Coors Light Silver Ticket promotion?
Excuse me, repeat that again?
Coors Light is giving away NFL tickets.
They do things that you don't see every day.
But coach, what's the point of the Silver Ticket promotion?
It's all about winning.
Yeah. Look for the official entry code inside specially marked packages of Coors and Coors Light for your chance to win NFL tickets, even Super Bowl tickets and more.
Coach, I am freaking out about this Silver Ticket promotion.
You have to learn to handle it, okay? You have to learn to handle your own intensity.
It's time for football, the Hooters way, where you get two spectator sports for the price of one. And if you really miss the stadium, we can always pour beer down your back and stand in front of the TV. Crab, burgers, salads, wings, and shrimp. At Hooters, you don't have to settle for sports bar food. And you can catch all your favorite games here with our brand new big screen TVs.
And at Hooters, everybody gets a cheerleader.
Football the Hooters way. Pray for overtime.
I grew up with Star Wars. It's a thrill to watch my kids experience the same thing all over again.
I love the characters.
The action is awesome.
I would love to have a pet Wookiee.
The Star Wars trilogy is now available on individual DVDs to share with your family. For a limited time only, September 12th.
In an active life, athlete's foot can break your rhythm.
Lamisil AT treats four times faster than other leading products for results on the bottom that work their way to the top. Lamisil AT. Go on.
Hi, I'm Eva LaRue, and this is my daughter.
Hiya.
And we're here to talk about a leading killer among women, ovarian cancer. This year, over 20,000 women will be diagnosed and nearly 80% won't find out until it's advanced. Early detection is imperative. If you experience persistent swelling, bloating, pain, or pressure in the abdomen for more than 2 weeks in a row, visit a gynecologist. It's time to break the silence and change the trend for the next generation. To learn more, visit the National Ovarian Cancer Coalition's website at ovarian.org or call 1-888-OVARIAN.
I help UNICEF because every life is important, and by helping UNICEF, you save a life.
If I was lacking in health or food, I would want someone to help me.
Helping UNICEF makes me feel like, oh, I was needed. That makes me proud.
You can't just tell yourself, if I don't help these people, someone else will. We're all together on Earth, and we need to help each other out. Because that's what being a civilized person is.
SportsCenter, brought to you by Alltel Wireless. Want to choose who you call for free? Get My Circle from Alltel Wireless. And Rocky Mountain Refreshing Coors Light. Taste the cold.
All right, entering play tonight in the American League Central in the wild card, the Tigers lead the Twins in the Central Division by four, conveniently opening up a four-game series tonight. Minnesota leads the White Sox in the wild card by a mere half game. All three teams currently in action. That can only mean one thing. Exclusive in-progress highlights. Baseball Tonight Extra and Carl Ravitch.
All right, Steve, thank you very much. In fact, only two games in the American League, and they involve the three teams that you had just mentioned. So we'll start with that key series, Tigers and Twins, four-game set. Curtis Granderson, Tim Kirchner, what a start for Detroit.
Well, this is what they need. They have not been a good offensive team lately, but they really went after Scott Baker, very aggressive, and hit him hard.
Baker wasn't good. Granderson's 14th. Marcus Thames waiting, watching, and walking around the bases, his 25th of the season, Detroit 3-0, and they needed one of those this is a prove it to you type start, and Verlander gave it to him. Seven innings, an earned run, five Ks. Detroit makes a little statement here. They beat the Twins by a score of 7-2. White Sox with a chance to move back on top in the wild card race. Ozzie Guillen and company chewing hard. Top five, Victor Martinez swinging a drive. Mark Burley wasn't very good either.
You know, he'd been really good his last two times out, but 10 hits in four innings tonight, that's just not going to get it done.
Four earned runs. There's Burley. Johnny Peralta in the top of the sixth. Uribe, pretty play, and that's a double play as he flips the second for the out. Bottom six. Well, the White Sox had used someone like Cliff Lee. He was very good. Dye is being yelled at by the color and play-by-play man. There's only one out. He forgot. He's doubled out at second. That won't sit well at all. The Indians rolling the White Sox as Chicago bats in the bottom of the ninth. So it's going to stay the same based on the scores right now. And it's amazing. The White Sox, who instilled so much confidence last year with their pitching, Contreras was good. And then after that, it kind of goes downhill.
Right. Their pitching has been so erratic this year compared to last year. And yet you could still make a case that they're the leader for the wild card here because the Twins pitching is all banged up with Radke and Liriano, even though it looks like he'll be back in a week. But either way, these are the teams fighting for the wild card. The Tigers are not going to blow this. They had a four-game lead with 22 to play. Only 10 times in history, only twice in the last 35 years, has a team blown that lead with that few games to play.
Good news for Detroit. More coming up on Baseball Tonight. Back to you guys.
Thanks a lot, Ravi. Dodgers and Mets baseball, all about the NL division leaders. Tom Glavine doing his thing, and Jose Reyes doing his. They love this kid. He even dropped the ball in the game, still got a standing ovation from the crowd almost. Bottom six, if they cheer to catch and cheer to drop, what you think the people's going to do about this? Reyes to center. The Mets get their second inside the park home run this year. It's the 10th time in the bigs. And he even looked like he had a little bit of energy left afterwards, maybe. Take another look. Here's how long it takes Jose Reyes to round the bases. Smack. You've heard of 4-4-40s? Well, how about a 14.5 trot around the bases? And by the way, with the win, Tom Glavine ties Tommy John, fifth most wins ever by a left-handed pitcher, 288. It's Glavin's first win in more than a month, and he worked into the seventh inning for the 14th time this season. As an, oh, by the way, the Mets win their second straight shutout, win this one 7-0. Talked about Glavin doing his thing. Now, look, he's not going to catch Warren Spahn, and he probably is not going to catch Steve Carlton. But talk about a list. Tom Glavin, Tommy John, joining the likes of Lefty Grove, Steve Carlton, and Warren Spahn. Not bad company. Friday night on ESPN, these two division leaders continue their four-game set. Dodgers trying to hang on to the NL West. Mets continue their countdown to the NL East title. I don't know, maybe the LA can score some runs, maybe. Check it out, ESPN Friday, 7 Eastern.
Week two of the college football season kicked off tonight. Find out what was the biggest surprise from the opening week from our experts. That's straight ahead.
Can anyone tell me what happened to Napoleon when he tried to invade Russia? Brian?
Hey, Ryan.
Somebody's going to get their first loss here tonight. It's not going to be us, is it?
No, sir!
Take a knee.
We can take them.
Got 22 wide cross. Be open, Ryan.
Gotcha. Fourth down, last chance of the Hawks.
Blue 80. All right, the ball, Ryan. Green in, try to go. Come on, Ryan.
If there were a store in your town called Peace of Mind, would you pay it a visit? Across America, in towns big and small, there is such a place, New York Life. It starts with our values of financial strength, integrity, and humanity, and continues with our agents. So look for us in your town. You may already know our people, and we are confident that Peace of Mind is why New York Life is the company you keep.
Ram is protection. No matter what you drive, no matter how you drive it. Before you slam it, Ram it.
Honesty, privacy, respect, and great rates. That's why people who use eLoan are spreading the word. Those are just some of the revolutionary ways we're changing the lending industry. eLoan, radically simple.
Witness, you may proceed.
With my circle, Alltel customers can call any number on any network for free.
Your Honor, my clients want their identities protected from this My Circle.
Call any network for free.
What were you thinking?
We were thinking our customers would like it.
I object!
I bet you do.
My Circle from Alltel Wireless, America's largest network. You choose the people you call for free. Any number, any network.
Men's quarters from the U.S. Open, the 7-seed Nikolai Davydenko and the 14-seed Tommy Haas. Davydenko looking for a comeback. He won the third set after dropping the first two sets. Davydenko delivers a nice backhand winner. He'd later win the fourth set 6-4. So in the fifth set, Davydenko up 3-2, serving in the far court. Davydenko rips a backhand winner to go up 4-2 and pounds the old thighs in frustration.
Ow.
Davydenko serving match point. Haas, a weak return. Davydenko, a power forehand winner to win the match. 4-6, 6-7, 6-3, 6-4, 6-4. Davydenko won their only previous meeting. That was straight sets in the fourth round of last year's French Open. So, Nikolai Davydenko has played more matches, 76 of them, than any man on the tour this year. And he's 3-0 when they go five sets. He reaches his second career Grand Slam semifinal. The other was last year's French. and he's the fifth different Russian to reach the U.S. Open semifinals in the Open era. College football now. We learned a little something about Texas quarterback Colt McCoy last Saturday. Going to learn a little more about him this Saturday night. It was Ohio State's visit, 8 Eastern on ABC. Marks just the second time ever the number one team in the land landed in Austin. 1950, the Longhorns beat top-ranked SMU. As for learning something about McCoy right now, he gave up drinking soda in the sixth grade. He told the Dallas Morning News, hasn't had a carbonated drink since. Not one beer. Instead, got milk? About a half gallon a day. That's good material for his mates to give him a hard time. Darren Lynn now reports on Texas's attempt to give Teddy Ginn Jr. a hard time.
Ted may be as explosive as any player in the country.
Ted Ginn Jr. had just 2 catches for 9 yards against Texas last year. It was his worst performance of the season. And yet Coach Mack Brown made sure Ginn would not be overlooked in their game plan for Saturday's matchup against Ohio State. This was before Terrell Brown was suspended. Now the Longhorns have to find a game plan to stop Ginn without one of their best cornerbacks.
That's a concern for us now, and we've got to try to figure out what to do between now and Saturday. What you try to do is just keep his plays from just absolutely taking over and killing you. Jim Tressel does such an outstanding job of moving Ted around that you can't just put a guy on him.
Either junior Brandon Foster or sophomore Ryan Palmer will line up against Ginn. Neither has ever started in a game. Texas will also have to depend on strong safety Michael Griffin to help out. Griffin, who led the team in tackles last year, says he believes Ginn can't be stopped on every down and hopes to limit his big yardage plays.
I think he's going to make his plays. He's a great player. He does it every game. I don't think there's any way really to stop him. We just got to go out there as a defense and try to just maintain and execute the defense.
Michael is such an outstanding safety and team leader for us that what he'll have to do is help out on either side, because you're not going to cover Ted with one guy. You're going to have to use two some.
In explaining his decision to suspend Brown for such a big game, Coach Brown said, quote, "When a young man has some personal issues, it's a distraction for him." With the Longhorns, Darren Lynn, ESPN.
Well, Darren, since Texas beat Ohio State last season, Teddy Ginn Jr. has 52 receptions, 842 yards, and 5 scores. Also had a punt return for a touchdown. The Buckeyes' lone loss since then was a 17-10 defeat at the hands of Penn State, a game in which Ginn, as you might expect, had only 40 all-purpose yards. More college football talk now. Here's Brian Kenny.
All right, 4 downs now with Mark Mann, Kirk Herbstreit. Mark, we start with you. Ted Ginn looked like a pro opening week. Can Texas limit him without Terrell Brown?
I think they can, and I think you're looking at a great defensive coordinator in Gene Chizik for Texas. They will devise a way to take him out of their game plan, and they will not take him totally out, but what they'll do is they'll limit the big plays. They don't want him running wild in the open field like this and getting open as he did in the opener against Northern Illinois, but they'll let him catch a couple of passes across the middle. But if he does, Michael Griffin, the safety, will be right there waiting for him to make him pay the price. But Ted Ginn's not going to average 30 yards a reception as he did in the opener.
Mark, I don't think there's any question. Texas can stop Ted Ginn Jr. with the defense that they have and the secondary that they have without Terrell Brown. I personally think that on the other side, Aaron Ross might be their best cover guy. He's big, he's athletic, he moves around. And remember, when you lose one guy, what this will do is it'll hurt the other side of this defense. But still, it's the front seven, it's the pass rush, it's Gene Chizik and his scheme. So sure, it's obvious you lose Terrell Brown, it takes away a guy who's got a great deal of experience, but the question is, can they win without Terrell Brown? Can they stop Ted Ginn Jr.? Absolutely.
Hey, Kirk, give us a name now. This game will be a coming-out party for who?
Well, with that said, I think a guy to look out for is Anthony Gonzalez. I think there's going to be so much attention being paid to Ted Ginn Jr. for obvious reasons, his big playability, that the guy on the other side might be a step quicker, and that's Anthony Gonzalez. He is a great burst. He's a great compliment on the other side. Teddy Ginn Jr. is a guy that I think gets so much attention that you'll see Troy Smith a lot of times when it's a crucial down, he'll try to go to number 11. So, Mark, I think you have to look out for number 11 in this game, because Terrell Brown Brown being out might open it up for the other receiver, not so much Teddy.
That's a great point, but my guy for coming out party is Jamal Charles, the running back from Texas. He was kind of overlooked last year because of the success of quarterback Vince Young. But here's the key. He averaged 7.4 yards a carry last year, 11 touchdown rushes last year. Not only that, in the opener, he played limitedly, had 77 yards for over 5 yards a carry. When you've got a big, huge offensive line that averaged 315 pounds, led by Justin Blaylock, led by Casey Stutter, I think that this is going to be his coming out party. If he gets 25 or 30 carries this game, he could well go over 200 yards rushing.
Again, that's 1 vs. 2 Saturday night on ABC. All right, guys. Mark, start with you. What surprised you most in week one?
Oh, it was the Tennessee Volunteers on both sides of the ball. Their offense and their defense. John Chavis, their defensive coordinator, came up with a magnificent defensive plan, but it was on offense. And if you look at Eric Ainge, he was able to distribute the ball, make big plays offensively, get the ball to Robert Meacham, the wide receiver. And here, running the football. One thing that Tennessee showed me in this game was not only their mental toughness, but their physical toughness on both sides of the ball, Kurt. They're a totally different team in that game against Cal than they were the entire season last year.
Yeah, Mark, and now the big question for them is, can they continue? Now that they've had some success, can they keep that fight that's been missing there the last couple years? I think the biggest surprise to me over the entire weekend had to be Florida State's composure. The way they were on the road, it looked like the game might get out of hand there towards the end of the first half. I thought they showed a lot of composure, made some adjustments, and again, the much maligned offensive coordinator, Jeff Bowden, give him a lot of credit for hanging in there, going back at halftime, finding some adjustments, going to the fade, dumping the ball underneath to Booker and letting Anton Smith make some plays. So I thought Florida State showed a lot of composure considering what was at stake and the way they came back to win in the Orange Bowl. That is not an easy thing to do.
Hey, Kirby, I think those are great points, but what about those two personal foul penalties that led to scores for Miami out of the Florida State defense?
Well, that's what I'm saying. As the second half adjustments.
Okay.
You're killing
okay,
me here.
Okay.
Second half adjustments. That's the composure. They're about to go down 14-3 because of those penalties.
Could have been worse. Hey, Mark, what about Montana State? No Montana State? That didn't surprise you a little bit?
No, that was a big surprise for everybody, but you thought Colorado would be a much better football team. But I think the key here is, as you look across the nation, there were some surprises. But to me, it's got to be Tennessee, the Tennessee Volunteers. The way that they were decimated last year by injury, by players that didn't play well, Phil Fulmer really took the bull by the horns this offseason and said, we're going to change our mental philosophy. We're going to prepare our team differently. We're going to work harder. We're going to be accountable. And they were in the first football game.
Hey, Kirk, I audibled there. Who was the most physical team you saw there week one?
The most physical team, I'm going to say the most physical player, Buster Davis from Florida State. Standing down there on the field and watching this team play defense and watching Buster Davis all over the field, I thought he really challenged Miami. I thought time after time he was there to come up with a big play, whether it was a sack, whether it was hitting a Miami Hurricane running back on a crucial down. I thought he really set the tone for, again, you knew a game was going to be low scoring. The Florida State defense was able to answer the bell, and I think a lot of that had to do with the leadership they received from their senior number 7 right there in the middle, Buster Davis.
I think that's a good pick, but my pick's Auburn. And the way that Auburn just decimated Washington State on both sides of the ball, when the head coach Bill Doba comes out and says, point blank, this is what he said: we had a long line down at the hospital when we returned home. I hope I do not see a defensive line any better than Auburn's the rest of the year. Quentin Groves, Josh Thompson, the defensive middle nose guard, they put a lot of pressure on Washington State. Huge hits in this game on both sides of the ball. But I think it was key. The speed, the athleticism, and the power of the defense of Auburn really came through in this football game. And that's a pretty decent Pac-10 team. Not a great Pac-10 team, but when you go in somebody else's backyard and the first thing you do is you talk about how physical the other team was as a head coach, I think that's key for Auburn because they are a physical football team.
Mark, thank you. Good chop block. Kirk, thank you.
Still ahead on SportsCenter, 3 comeback quarterbacks with lots to prove. Brett Favre, Carson Palmer, Dante Culpepper. Find out which signal caller has the most to prove this season. And the hunt for October in the American League. Will the fading Tigers see their division lead cut to 3 games in many? Or will the White Sox take over the top spot in the wild card race?
Only one DVD offers performance worthy of the X Games. Maxell DVD. Maximum speed. Maximum precision. Maximum power. That's why Maxell is the official DVD of X Games 12. Maxell, performance that will blow you away. Maxell products available at Best Buy.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Shh. But the little tortilla strips in it make it crunchy.
Well, don't let Dave hear. You know he always has to be the fun guy.
Oh, too late.
Guys, keep it down. Honestly. So unprofessional.
Taco Bell's new Nacho Crunch Grilled Stuffed Burrito. Carne asada steak, warm nacho cheese sauce, and crunchy tortilla strips wrapped up and grilled to go. For the burrito that's fun to crunch.
Crunchy.
Wow. Think outside the bun.
UPS, covering more ground faster than ever.
After you.
Oh, thanks.
Have a nice day.
UPS, covering more ground faster than ever.
The world's greatest sandwich delivery.
I love this outfit!
Before you spend your money, spend your time with Fine Living. Weekdays beginning at 5, we have a 3-hour block of shows we call Buyer's Guides. You work hard, and we want to help you get the best deals on the things you buy the most. Buyer's Guides, weekdays beginning at 5 on Fine Living. Online at fineliving.com.
Brought to you by your local Lincoln Mercury dealers, who invite you to test drive our new lineup. Or check them out at LincolnMercury.com.
Probably the biggest series in baseball this weekend. 4-game set, Tigers and the Twins. Jim Leland's guys have a 4-game lead. Opening up in Minnesota, Kurt Granderson leading off Scott Baker. Well, he's no Anderson, he's Granderson. His 14th of the year, 1-0 Tigers. Top of the second, one on. Marcus Thames getting in the swing of things. It's a 2-run jack of his own. His 25th of the season. Make it 3-0 in favor of first place Detroit, who said they were fading. Man on in the fourth. Omar Infante base hit. Brandon Inge trying to get the third. Michael Kadire has himself an arm and guns him out at third for the out. Top of the fifth. Runner on. Pudge time. Rodriguez. Singles in the right center. Curtis Granderson going to third. Granderson will make it, and the throw allows Rodriguez to get to second. Scoring position. Next batter, you knew it was coming. Said scoring position. Craig Monroe, the single, 2-run score, making 5-0 Tigers. With 6-1 in the bottom of the seventh, Justin Verlander still in there and in a bit of a jam. And Verlander, first and second, he's out of the jam. Got Jason Bartlett. Verlander, 7 innings, 8 hits, 1 earned run. Tigers win easily. As we jump on board the rookie pitcher's Victory Express, what a season for Justin Verlander. With tonight's win, he improves to 16-7 for the Tigers. In case you're wondering, the last rookie to win as many as 16 games in a season, got to go back to 2002, Jason Jennings of the Rockies. He went 16-8 in 2002, went on to win the National League Cy Young Award. Last Tigers rookie to pitch and win as many as 16 games, you have to go back to 1976. Who doesn't love the bird? Mark Fidrich won 19 and the AL Rookie of the Year that season.
Just got wrapped up. Ozzie Guillen and the White Sox looking to stay in the mix of the AL wild card. They host the Indians. Top five, Victor Martinez, as cool as the other side of the pillow. Takes Mark Burley out. Victor's 14th home run of the season. Burley, 4 innings, tied for his shortest outing of the year. Bottom five, Indians up 7-0. Cliff Lee pitching and pitching well. Gets Ozuna to ground one at third. Andy Marte gets the force out at second. Lee finished 6 innings, 5 hits, 1 earned run. Top six, Johnny Peralta, bat facing Charlie Hagner. Hager with the runner on. Juan Uribe, nice catch, 52nd, double play. Unorthodox, it worked. Bottom six, Cliff Lee facing Rob Mikoviak. 2 on, 1 out, Mikoviak to left center. Jermaine Dye kind of forgets there's 1 out. He's just kind of hanging out. He says, man, I got 40 homers this year for the first time ever, but I got played. Indians going to win the game, 9-1. The hunt for October There is no Sean Connery who talks like he has rocks in his mouth. We will tell you that the Tigers, five games up on the Twins in the AL Central. White Sox still breathing there at 5.5. White Sox have a better time in the wild card, just a half game back of the Twinkies. Still ahead, Matt Leinart, Vince Young, or Jay Cutler. Which rookie QB will spend the season holding a clipboard, and who's going to get the most starts? That's coming up. And the Manning Bowl kicks off in primetime Sunday. Will Eli finally steal the spotlight from his big brother, Peyton? He's only beat him in one thing, a pickup basketball game in high school, and that got heated.
He's sitting on 7-14. Here's the pitch by Downing.
Vote at Century21.com for the Hank Aaron Award, voted solely by the fans, and win a trip to a 2006 World Series game, because the fans are why the players take the field, and why some of them turn out to be legends.
And listen to this crowd!
Xbox 360 is pleased to announce that Aaron Custer has joined our Madden NFL 017. Come on up here, A-Train. All right, now I'll open it up to some questions.
Hey, Aaron, where did you play before?
Mostly at a friend's house or the electronics department at Walmart.
Do you think you'll be ready for the next game?
I really gotta do laundry, but yeah, I should be ready.
Ready for everyone. Madden NFL 07 on Xbox 360 is the only way to play in high def so real you'll check your TV for grass stains. Get it at Walmart.
I thought they were gonna be cheerleaders.
Every day, someone like you waits for an organ donation while life passes by.
Like I said, I don't wanna wait. I don't wanna wait.
Join Illinois' new organ tissue registry. Even if you're already a donor, you must sign up again. Go to lifegoeson.com today. With your help, the wait will not be in vain.
There's a natural resource that exists everywhere on the planet that could help end poverty. Yet it's been largely ignored. That resource is women. In many of the world's poorest communities, their potential often remains untapped.
I am powerful.
I am powerful.
I am powerful.
It's a source of power the world can no longer afford to overlook. She has the power to change her world. You have the power to help her do it.
November 19th, 1973, Burt Reynolds stops by the booth to share a laugh with Howard Cosell.
We look for a super game tonight. And as you can readily see, I have undergone cosmetic surgery. The face has changed, but the body is superbly unchanged.
Kornheiser's that funny. College football, Oregon State, Boise State. It is the anniversary of the Smurf Turf, Blue Turf. First quarter, Sammy Strada at the 36-yard line, and he takes that 64 yards to the house. Beavers go up 14-0. And you got to remember, Boise State's won 32 straight games at home. Still first quarter. Check this out. Tad Miller, nice kickout block. That brings Ian Johnson, and Ian Johnson is gone. My man takes it 59 yards. Broncos cut the lead to 14-7. Ian Johnson was just getting started. Second quarter tied at 14, first and goal. Ian, he had 21 carries. Five of those carries ended up in the end zone. That's a three-yard touchdown. That ties it at 14. Third quarter, Broncos up 28-14. Johnson up the middle. That's one, two, three, four busted tackles. 19-yard touchdown. Boise State up 35-14. Fourth quarter, first down midfield for Boise. Check out Pete Cavender, another great block. Johnson, career high, 240 yards rushing, five touchdowns. Boise State was down 14-0. And then kids ripped off 42 straight points. And it was, we've now won 32 straight games at home. Game, set, and match. Ian Johnson, fat night, yo. 240 yards rushing. It was actually 240. That is the third best rushing game in Boise State history, and his five touchdowns tied a school record. As the longest tenured Washington Redskin, O-lineman Joe Jansen's words carry weight. And Thursday, he only backed down from his words a little bit. Last night, on an HBO broadcast, he estimated that 15 to 20% of NFL players use illegal performance-enhancing drugs. Today, he said, quote, what I meant was that it was a small number of players. Being a football player, I'm not that good at math, close quote. Still, Jansen adds, it would be naive and foolish to think players aren't using human growth hormones. With more NFL, here's Chris McKendry.
Coors Light Cold Hard Facts, a six-pack of questions previewing, predicting even the upcoming season. Mark Schlereth, Darren Woodson here to break it down. Darren, you're up first. Who's going to have the better overall season, Terrell Owens or Steve Smith?
Well, I'm going with Steve Smith because Terrell Owens is coming into a new offense. So Steve Smith, of course, 1-on-1 on the outside, probably the best wide receiver in football. Add that with Keyshawn Johnson on the other side. Steve Smith no longer will be double-teamed. He'll have some 1-on-1 situations, and we all know what he can do when he gets out in the open field. He's a star in the making. He was a star last year. He's going to be even bigger this year.
All right, Mark, you're up next. Question number two of our six-pack of questions. Which comeback quarterback has the most to prove this season, Favre, Culpepper, or Palmer?
Well, I'm going to go with Brett Favre, and Culpepper and Palmer proved it in the preseason that they are healthy, they are ready to roll. But Brett Favre, to me, is a guy that has to hone it in. He's got to manage his game if this Green Bay Packers team is going to have a chance to perform. No more of this tippy-toe stuff, no more throwing it around. You have got to be on target and help your team win. You can't go freelancing, and that's what his problem has been in the past.
Darren, which rookie quarterback will get the most starts, Leinart, Young, or Cutler?
I'm going with Leinart. And when you look at what's happening with this Arizona team and Kurt Warner, in the past, Kurt Warner has struggled as far as being healthy and playing an entire season. Leinart's a guy who understands that pro-style offense. This team seemed to rally behind him in the preseason game, even though he held out. This kid's ready to play now.
All right, under-the-radar player ready for a breakout season. Mark?
Well, I'm going to go, and you guys are going to be surprised. I'm going to go with my former team, the Denver Broncos, and Mike Bell. Not the T-Bell, the M-Bell, because Mike Bell right now understands what he is asked to do, and that is to run downhill and, boom, be physical at the end of those runs. Listen, you in the Denver Broncos system, you're going to get 1,200 yards. You're going to get 12 TDs. He's going to get plenty of opportunity. Mike Bell, my breakout runner for the Denver Broncos.
Well, far from under the radar, they play each other in primetime Sunday. Better performance when the Colts and the Giants meet week one.
I'm going with Big Brother, of course, Chris. So you got to go with the Big Brother, Peyton Manning. Peyton is a guy that understands this game. He has those weapons on the outside, Marvin Harrison and Reggie Wayne. They know how to pass, throw the ball. They know how to run the ball. This is Peyton Manning's stage. And he's going to upstage his little brother.
All right. Well, right now, all 32 teams have hope, Mark.
Mm-hmm.
Dash somebody's week one upset to watch.
Well, I'm going to go Chicago Bears traveling to the Green Bay Packers up in Lambeau Field, and I'm going with the Green Bay Packers to upset the Chicago Bears. Why? Because the Chicago Bears have zero offense. They've done nothing in the offseason to improve themselves, and that does not bode well. I know they were the NFC North champions last year, but at some point, the defense and the offense will become fractured because there is no offense, and that creates tough times in Chicago. Mark my words.
Preseason. Preseason's over with. It's the big boys are playing now, Mark.
I know. I understand that.
Week one upset.
Ooh, you know what? I was going to go Chicago. You know, there aren't going to be any upsets this weekend. It is what it is this week.
All right. Darren Woodson taking the easy way out. Mark Schlereth. Coors Light, Cold Hard Facts.
Coors Light, Cold Hard Facts. Brought to you by Rocky Mountain Refreshing Coors Light. Taste the cold.
Coming up. Ready to head for the Berg. It is all but over between the Dolphins and the Steelers. We'll have highlights, live reaction, and analysis coming up. And James Blake, 0-4 against the number one seed Roger Federer, with the Americans' luck changed tonight at the U.S. Open. Highlights on the way.
Hey, Coach, you're a fan of the Coors Light Frost Brew liner, right?
Darn right.
Wouldn't you say it locks in that Frost Brew taste?
I can say it with confidence.
Coach, would you say the Frost Brew liner rocks?
I think that's probably as well as I can state it. I don't know.
Every Coors Light can is a specially designed liner to lock in that refreshing frost-brewed taste.
Coach, I started lifting again.
Can you tell?
I don't see any changes that would be visible, you know. I...
All stations, hostile tracking inbound.
Imagine simultaneously tracking over 100 enemy targets on land, sea, and in the air from thousands of miles away. It's the most powerful weapon system ever invented. It's called Aegis, and it's just one of the amazing technologies you'll find only in the United States Navy. Navy, accelerate your life. Log on to the...